wrong in here tonight. Or it could be my aftershave. But either way, what a great atmosphere. Yes, indeed, I'm Warwick Davis, and are there any Star Wars fans in here tonight? Some of you may recognize me as Wald or Weasel from The Phantom Menace, or perhaps as Woolivan from The Force Awakens, or even Weetie Sayubi from Rogue One. Where is he? Oh, yes. A face only a mother could love there. Or perhaps I'm best known to all of you as Wicket the Ewok from Return of the Jedi. You know, it's such a thrill for me to be part of the Star Wars universe. I feel so honored to have been in all of the movies. It's absolutely fantastic. And tonight, we're going to hear some very exciting news about the future of Star Wars. Are you ready to go inside the galaxy's edge? Yeah! Well, I personally can't wait to find out more about what the brand new world of Batuu has to offer. I'm really excited about this. You know, my first experience with Star Wars was when I was just 7 years old, when I saw A New Hope. And I remember going home, getting my collection of action figures out and recreating moments from the films through the eyes of these figures. That's how I immersed myself in Star Wars back then. And then, at the age of 11, I was cast in Return of the Jedi. And then I was able to play and explore the set and imagine the possibilities of a real-life Star Wars experience. But then, the director said cut, and it was over. It wasn't real. But now, the future is, when we go to Batuu, no one's going to say cut. It's a fully immersive world that you can explore somewhere on the galaxy's edge. And I personally can't wait to get there myself. Now I think, are you ready to learn more about this new world? Yeah? Okay. And I'm going to welcome onto the stage, someone's going to help us guide us through the next 30 minutes. We're going to meet the architects of this new world, courtesy of your host, Mr. David Collins.
Studios. I have to tell you, I really relate to your story about being a huge Star Wars fan ever since I was a kid. How many of you love Star Wars just all your lives? Great story. Really, always inspiring to hear.
Yeah, I'm so excited to be here at Galactic Nights. It's a great evening, and you know, I'd love to stay and find out more about Batuu and all the new world and all that stuff, but I've got to go out into the park and experience what's going on, because also I'm making a huge surprise at the end of the night.
Oh!
Yeah, okay. I've got to go and work on getting that all together.
It's a surprise.
It's top secret. It is a surprise.
End of the night.
But you're all invited, okay? Out there in the center of the park, okay?
Warwick Davis, ladies and gentlemen. Give us a round of applause. Galactic Knights, how are you doing? My name is David Collins, and for the next half hour, I will be your host here at our sneak peek at Star Wars Galaxy's Edge. You know, like Warwick and our panelists, I've been a Star Wars fan all my life. I've been lucky enough to work behind the scenes for roughly the last 20 years or so, first as a sound designer in video games, and then as a voice actor in Force Awakens, Last Jedi, and Rogue One. But I've been a fan all of my life, and like our panelists, like Warwick, I care about this property, this galaxy far, far away so deeply. And because of this, I've started hosting and hopefully having an opportunity to answer your questions and stand up here and learn more, all of the secrets that we want to know about this land that we get to go to in 2019. You know, I went to Imagineering. This was like torture. I went to Imagineering and I couldn't say anything. I had to sign my life away, and they showed me the model, and I floored over the model. They showed me what the attractions were going to be like, and I got to experience early versions of those. They told me what it was going to be like to go to Batuu, and I couldn't say anything. Tonight is our night to share some of those details. I even asked if I could take a picture. Can I just take a picture of one thing? No. Okay, what about now? No. Can I at least take a picture of something? Just one. Just give me one to share, you know, at Galactic Nights. They said, well, yeah, you can take a picture in the conference room. Gosh, even the conference room is awesome at Imagineering. Mere feet away from when Walt Disney himself himself is looking at audio animatronics in Pirates of the Caribbean. There is a group of Star Wars experts working on Batuu, Galaxy's Edge. Tonight, we're going to learn more about it. Let's waste no more time. Let's get our experts up here. Please welcome Scott, Doug, Robin, and Chris up to the stage. But I wanted to start with you, Scott, to just give, for those of you that don't know, just give an overview of what Star Wars Galaxy's Edge is, of Batuu, and get us caught up to speed.
Oh yeah, happy to. I guess it's been about 2.5 years since we first announced that we were going to build an immersive Star Wars land. And I think at that time we actually said it was going to be the largest land expansion that we've ever built in the company. And I still feel like, you know, Star Wars deserves something big, don't you guys agree?
Yeah.
So we're gonna go big. And actually, that's appropriate because Star Wars is a huge franchise. It's a huge galaxy of stories and characters. And this opportunity for us to go to Batuu, which you can see here, is it's an amazing opportunity for us to start to live our Star Wars story. And Batuu is a great place, a great stepping off point for all those adventures. I mean, we could have gone to like Tatooine and remembered Luke's story, or some other planet and remembered some other character's story. But Batuu is a place where we're going to get to live our Star Wars story and kind of be the hero of that, right? So we have to double down on all the authenticity and the kind of attention to detail, right? Everything needs to help tell the story. Even like our drinking fountains, right? I mean, even there, you want some surprise and delight. Those do not look like that. I'm sure they're going to be fine.
It's got that lived-in Star Wars look.
Everything in Star Wars has to feel that way, right?
Right.
Be a little bit of a, you know, provide more detail, more story around every corner, right? Even the merchandise that you're going to be able to get in our street market, or the exotic food and beverages from across the galaxy, all that is designed to help pull you into Star Wars, to help you believe you're having your own Star Wars adventure. I can't wait. I have to wait.
All of it. Wait, also the food and beverages, the merchandise,
yes.
All of it,
yes.
Is part, yes, of this planet. But
yes, even the conference room table.
Even the conference room,
yes,
table.
Yes, all of it is there to help tell, you know, for you to immerse yourself in this world that you've been wanting to be a part of, that I've been wanting to be a part of for, you know, almost 4 years.
Well, you know what's interesting is that, I mean, I'm sure you all feel the same way. I used to get asked by my friends when I, let's say I was in college, and I'm supposed to be doing my homework, and I would finish it early so I could read the latest Thrawn novel, or I could play X-Wing on my roommate's PC or something like that. And they used to say to me, when are you ever going to get tired of Star Wars? And I said, you know, even if I stepped onto the Death Star itself, or even if I got a chance to fly the Falcon, I still wouldn't be tired of Star Wars.
Well, you know what? I think you might be able to put that to the test, because not only are you going to be able to explore this exotic planet, but we're also going to give you the opportunity and invitation to step into some pretty amazing epic experiences. And one of them does put you in the middle of a climactic battle between the First Order and Resistance. Doesn't that look awesome?
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, this is like real. This is going to be like real.
Right, but that's a real place.
That's a real place.
In 2019, that's a place we can go.
It is in 2019 a place you can go. You may be forced to.
No pun intended.
Yeah. And the other big attraction experience, David, I think you're going to be happy with this, is going to be an invitation for you to get behind the controls of the Millennium Falcon, not just step onto it, but get it behind the controls and take it on your own customized intergalactic joyride.
So not just be in the Millennium Falcon, but to actually fly the Millennium Falcon and have choices.
You absolutely have choices. You're in control, so where you go is totally up to you. Please be gentle.
And I have to wait until 2019 to do this. I'm so excited. I can't believe it. Well, so I mentioned to you all that I went to Imagineering. Robin, you're the executive producer. I want to just ask you, how far along are we? How is it going? You know, where are we this week in the process of bringing Batuu to life?
It's fine. We're building the parks on both coasts, right? So you can see it over the construction tents. If you guys were out here, you could probably see things peeking up. So,
how many of you peaked at the behind that fence? What time of year?
You're probably the type that shave your presents on holidays too, right? So no debating. So yes, we're building here and we're building in Anaheim. I think we have some footage, some drone footage that was taken just a couple of days ago. And so you can see, if you had a better view over the fence, what you would see. The steel is going up now. This is really exciting. When you see on a site, when you see the evergreen tree on the top of that spike there, that's the tallest part. It's a construction tradition I learned today that comes from Scandinavia. That's the tallest peak on the site. So it's going fast. Chris and I were on the site in Anaheim last week.
Yeah.
And we walked out in the morning.
Yeah, we walked out in the morning. There was just cleared the site for one of our dining experiences, and Robin and I went in and had a meeting, came out like 2 hours later and the building was up. I don't know how they assembled steel so fast, but it was incredible. But Anaheim is progressing rapidly as well. I mean, we just started our love our carving on our rock works. We're actually getting to see those spires come to life, and it's exciting. It breathes fresh air into the team because, you know, years and years of hard work, and you're seeing everything on two-dimensional drawings, and finally you have to walk out of the site and actually see it come to life. It gives us goosebumps every day. It's like Christmas every day for us. It's great.
And that was Hollywood Studios that we just saw.
Yes.
That's just right outside, just a week ago. That's branding footage. That's incredible. And you know, it reminds me of when I first heard that you were doing a giant expansion at the Disney parks for Star Wars. In my mind, I was like, oh, that's great. I'll go to Tatooine and I'll see a pod race, and I'll go to Hoth and get an ice cream cone, and maybe my kid will get to play on the Jungle Gym of Endor or something like that. With my version was like almost like a Star Wars mall or something. You know, but you decided to actually build a place that exists in the galaxy far, far away, a real place and part of that universe. Can you talk about that decision, that process, either Robin or Doug? Doug Chang from Lucasfilm, ladies and gentlemen. Doug Chang from Lucasfilm, ladies and gentlemen. Can you talk about just the concept of taking us to a real place?
Yeah, and that's one of the great things about Star Wars, is that we always try to ground our locations based on the characters. And for example, I mean, Tatooine is a perfect example of Luke's homestead. I mean, Luke, you know, in the story, in The New Hope, he's kind of a simple person. I mean, you know, he's a simple farmer. He's a moisture farmer. And he longs for adventure. And so he really wants to escape the mundane life that he has. So the bleak desert of Tatooine really kind of mirrors that, because it reflects the emptiness in his life, that he actually wants to escape this. Vader's castle, on the other hand, is something else that we developed, you know, early on. And it's interesting, because in Vader's castle, we actually want to go the other way. We want to make a statement. We want to put a sort of a bold statement that this is Vader's place. And if you look at his castle, it's literally like a stake in the ground. And everything about Mustafar reinforces who Vader is. And I think this was really important for us because we wanted to imbue the environment with Vader's character. So, for instance, in the sky, it's dark brooding clouds. We have fumes from the lava field. Everything kind of makes you feel really unsettled. You get a sense that there's impending doom. Anything, you know, you could get killed at any moment at this environment. You know, just like Vader. And like Vader, who channels the dark energy of Force, we actually designed his castle mirror that. It's actually like a tuning fork. It's tuning the dark energy and amplifying for Vader. One of the fun things about it, in one of these slides, you'll notice that the lava field dam that we made actually has a really interesting form language that conveys menace. I mean, it really looks like teeth. And the idea there is, again, is to make you unsettled. We took that same form language and actually applied it to the interior. We took a lot of Vader's costume motif. And if you go inside, you'll notice that his chamber, the doorway to his chamber, mirrors the mouth of his helmet. And the idea there is that when you go into his chamber, you're literally being visually consumed by Vader. And it's one of those things where, you know, we try to do that for all of the Star Wars designs, because it then anchors and creates memorable places that then reinforces the story.
Yeah. And the chip's no different, right? I mean, that the reason that we have spent so much time sweating the details on the planet's design is, much like those locations reflect the inner turmoil of those characters, the opportunities of those characters, this place wants to represent a great stepping off point for our story. So it is rich with discovery and hidden alleyways to explore and surprise and new adventures around every corner, because that's the Star Wars that we want to live. We'll work on your mini mall version later. Yeah,
no, that's fine. I don't need it. But for me,
it's
fabulous.
It's
going to be great. Yeah. Thank you.
Now, we want to actually make sure that we're providing an opportunity for all of you to be in the story. You guys want that, right?
Yeah. We're the characters. We're the characters in Ratoon. That's when you're designing it with us in mind.
Yeah. We're doing it for, look, we're fans. But we are doing this for you guys, the fans, right? We are building this place for you. So I hope that that's going to work. I hope you guys like that build.
Well, based on just
listening. Pretty committed at this point, so I hope you guys like that.
That's for sure. Well, I just listened to you both talk. It's really exciting. It's always fun to listen to kind of, Doug, I can listen to you talk forever, but, you know, talking about production design, talking about story and Lucasfilm and all of the creativity that's going on in Imagineering. I am curious, though, Doug, since you're stepping into this world, can you talk a little bit about the difference between production design for a film versus a park that is something that you can go to and experience every day?
Yeah.
That actually, must be so different.
Yeah, no. In a funny way, the design process is exactly the same. The only difference is in the final product and the final construction. For instance, the things that we make for film are always designed for a very specific point of view, and it's the point of view of the camera. So we specifically design things to look good at certain angles. Like for instance, this is our partial set of the U-wing for Rogue One. And we only build what is absolutely necessary to convey that illusion of reality. And that allows us to do a lot of cheats.
Yeah, that doesn't work for us.
I know. Yes.
It would be a lot cheaper, yeah.
But if you look at the next slide, so this is our Yavin set from Rogue One again. And it looks absolutely real from the camera's point of view. We spent a lot of time set-dressed and build in all the details to paint it to look right, light it to look right. But if you look at the next slide, you see that it's just an illusion. It's actually, it's a movie set, of course. You can see our lighting rig. You can see that, the walls aren't really walls. They're actually, painted foam. Those aren't really rocks. And the reason we do that is film sets are meant to be tempered. They only need to last maybe a week or a month for however long it takes to shoot it. Constructions for the parks, however, are completely real. They're absolutely real, and it requires a level of authenticity that's unparalleled. This is a really fun example where this is how we also cheat in film, which is, sometimes in the building, this is just a painted flat of plywood. And it's one of those things where it's always about the creation of illusion. And one of the things that I really enjoy now working with the WDI team is that we're taking that fantasy version and actually making it real. And that's the joy that we have is, a lot of our stuff, like for instance, we're building a whole fleet of X-Wings. It is absolutely fantastic.
Time out. Can you just say what you just said one more time? You were building a what?
We're building a fleet of X-Wings for real.
You're building a fleet.
That's
the
fun part is that the movie versions that we made.
I'm so excited that I'm clapping.
And you do, and I am too. No, the funny thing is, the movie versions that we make are props. I mean, they're made out of wood and fiberglass and foam. The versions that you're going to see in the parks are the real deal. They're made out of 1/4-inch aluminum over a steel frame, just like a real aircraft. I mean, when you knock on it, it doesn't give. It just feels like a real thing. And that's where I like to think that, if we actually mounted engines on these could really fly. And the X-Wings that we're going to see in the parks are identical to the versions in the movie. The only difference is that these are built for real. For instance, all the details are absolutely authentic. Like the bolts are really bolts. The latches are real latches. And we even went so far as the graphics actually say something. They're not just for decoration. So it's that level of authenticity that is really kind of creating an immersive, sort of a complete immersive experience.
Wait. So if I go up to that X-Wing and there's like a warning, be careful as you step on board, there's going to be an Aurobesh warning before you get up. Really?
Exactly. And it'll tell you exactly what to do and what not to do. I know.
So it's going to be detailed.
Yes.
Be gentle.
Please, for God's sake,
I will, I promise. No joyrides. Okay.
There'll also be a friendly operations cast saying, please don't step on the ants.
You're the reason why we have to put rails around there.
Yes.
I am the reason. I'm the reason. I'm never going to imagine you again after this.
We can have a room retreat. Recently, I had a chance to check in on the Falcon as it's getting its finishing touches, and it is absolutely stunning. I mean, for the film version, as you know, we had several different versions. I believe we maybe even have, you know, six or more. And that included, like, you know, a couple of full-size versions. We had a 6-foot shooting miniature, and even a 2-inch shooting miniature, and then a bunch of digital versions. And curiously, they're all slightly different. And that's because they were all built for specific purposes. The one Falcon that you're going to see in the park and experience is going to be the real deal. It's the authentic thing. And it was surreal for me because I remember standing in front of it just recently and I was completely awestruck. It was just an amazing experience. And I just can't wait for all of you guys to have that same experience.
These are new photos. This is the first time anyone's going to see it. And a fleet of X-Wings, no big deal. I can't get over that. Well, that is incredible. Robin, I have to ask you, as executive producer, when you hear Doug talk in this way, what does that mean to you? I mean, in terms of executing all of this incredible real-world design?
Well, you know, it's funny because it's interesting for me to be sitting in this theater at Disney's Hollywood Studios because while this is a really ambitious project that we're working on, the first ambitious project that I worked on in my career was working on the team that built this park. So I was the project manager at Great Movie Ride back in the day. Which goes to show you that we build things in theme parks to last a little longer than we did in movies. Even though this park was all about the magic of movies, we built this to last, and what we're building for Delos, or what we're building for, whoops, what we're building for Batuu, she gets one. What we're building for Batuu is absolute. And when we think about how we're going to bring all of you into this experience, when you go to the movies, we all went to the, has anybody seen episode 8? Did you cry? I cried. So we all went and we get so excited, we think, how can we possibly top that? How can we possibly do anything better than what we just experienced in the theater together and collectively? And that's by taking you into it and letting you be in it. So the Falcon, we were just talking about the Falcon. Well, the Falcon's going to be here and you can go on to the Falcon. You will go on to the Falcon. You will go into the test room, you will go down those hallways, and you will go into the cockpit and fly the Falcon on a mission that you can control.
That picture of that hallway and this cockpit, this is not a set.
That's not from the movie.
That's the actual Falcon.
That's where you're going in 2019.
And so we're not just on Batuu, we're going to have missions beyond Batuu.
Well, and I think we're going to have a little, you know, spoiler alert for the people that are here. We are going on missions, and we're going to fly around Batuu, we're going to see some things, but we're going to take you to places beyond Batuu, and I think we have an image. We've been working here with Doug Chang and the team to develop a place that y'all haven't seen.
This is a really fun sequence where it's something fresh and it's something new, but it's going to feel completely Star Wars. So we have to expand the universe, and I think you're going to really enjoy it.
This is a never before seen. You guys have already
first time.
That's awesome. Yeah, and this is just one of the missions that you might find yourself faced with, right? If you choose to take on this adventure, and who knows how it's going to end up? Doesn't look like it's going to end up well, does it? That's up to you guys. How this ends up is totally up to you guys.
It's the Falcon, so you better bring it back in one piece.
Yeah. So we've heard so many great, that's incredible. I mean, we've heard so many great things about vehicles, about fleets of X-Wings. The Falcon's going to be at Batuu. But it's more than just what you were saying before. It's more than just vehicles. It's more than just flying missions. There's a whole planet that you're building, a whole city that we're going to see. Chris, can you tell us about those details beyond the ships?
Yeah, this, you know, designing a planet is about designing a character. And Scott talked a little bit about just how, you know, a planet and the, you know, is a reflection, Doug talked about this too, you know, the, a planet really is a reflection of the character. And so when we sit down, we started really looking at where we wanted to take our guests. You know, what planet do we want to take you to? The stop off or indoor, right, in this other place. It still had to be a place that was familiar, that still felt like Star Wars, right? And really at the beginning of the process, and by the way, there's an amazing partnership with Doug Chang and the design team at Lucasfilm and the story team. It is really one team. We are not two separate groups. We visit each other weekly, we have weekly check-ins, we take all of our trips together when we do our research trips, which I'm going to talk about here in a few minutes. But there, we are designing this thing together, and I think that's what's just going to really make it just, like I said, feel like Star Wars. Also, we look back and we did a lot of research and going back and looking at the work of Ralph McQuarrie. And Ralph was a, he was an art director.
Ralph McQuarrie.
Ralph McQuarrie. Ralph McQuarrie. Yeah. If you go back and look at Ralph's work, right, it is, well, I would say it's the Star Wars DNA, right? It's these big, heavy, monolithic forms. It's the domes that we see on the planet Tatooine. There's so much in his artwork that that you know we just respect and you know, I still ooze over. And so I'm not joking when I say we have a design board in the office that anytime a sketch comes off the table, we hold it up like, okay, does it look like Ralph would have bought off on this? And Doug, how do you feel about it? And so we talk about Ralph a lot. And, you know,
Ralph is sort of the gold standard for Star Wars, and of course, you know, we have to kind of live up to that legacy. I try really hard, but you know what, there's only one Ralph. We try to fill in for it as much as we can, and I think we succeeded.
Yeah, we are excited because I think that, you know, now that we get to walk the, you know, actually walk down the hallways and the pathways and the, you know, experience these spaces in reality now that it's up out of the ground, you can see, I think, that, like I said, that Ralph McQuarrie DNA coming to life. So back to like the history, you know, to create a history, we want this planet to feel like Scott said, it's this outpost on the edge of the galaxy. It's an old trading post. It has to have history. But to create history, you really have to do your research. You know, Imagineering and Lucasfilm, we are both, you know, we take pride in the details. We take pride in that we do our research. But for Batuu, we want it to be romantic. We want it to be ancient. It was an exotic nature to it. It had to be a little mysterious. A little bit of danger, you know. You turn the corner, you know. For the longest time, I said I'm going to turn the corner and almost like we'll get it mugged. Not that we're going to do that. We're not. It'll be safe, I promise. But there's a sense of danger, right? I mean, that's Star Wars, right? There's that sense of danger, but there's also the comedy aspect of it, right? And there's humor in Star Wars, and there's a lot of fun in Star Wars. And Scott always says, let's don't forget the fun that we bring to this place. And so we're going to make sure we have that in here. But we found ourselves really circling a couple places because you always want to base, so I feel, I mean personally, and Doug and I have had these conversations, that we want to base Star Wars in reality. If you think of Hoth, if you think of Tatooine, those are real places you can visit on this planet, right? They're not these fantasy places that are just made up. For Batuu, we really start looking at Istanbul, Morocco, and I don't mean over at Epcot Center, although that's really well done, and I do love to visit there from time to time. But we really start to go over and start to look at Istanbul and Morocco as far as these ancient ports, ports of trade. And so the image here you're seeing is from our research trip that we took. There were Lucasfilm.
They get to go on the trip, and
the
producer gets to
read
the expense report.
So if you get to choose creative director, not creative producer. We still have a lot.
Choices we make.
But what we found in Morocco were these amazing marketplaces. Just every time you turn the corner, there are amazing sights and smells and sounds that just brought this place to life. And you know, at night we would go back to the hotel and just have these incredible dinner conversations about, okay, well, if this is Morocco, what's Batuu? Like, if I turn the corner, like, where, you know, what do I hear? You know, do I hear droids arguing in the corner or some strange musical instrument playing from up in, you know, these little small hovels in the top of the buildings? Or can I go up to a weird cart in the marketplace and get some strange space meat sandwich and I walk around eating it? Or, you know, what am I walking on? You know, what are the cobbles? Or are they cobblestones at all? You know, do I look down in the dirt and I see droid tracks? And it's all about story. And when you build a story, it gives the place life. And it gives life to the Imagineers. Because the Imagineers, they can come in, and no matter what discipline you work in Imagineering, it gives you the framework to go off and do your design and contribute to that story. And that's really how we craft a project in Imagineering. And from what I've learned working with Doug and the team, Lucasfilm, I mean, they work a lot the same way early in the process.
So, I want to go!
2019,
that was amazing!
So a couple more things, and we'll just share a couple more images with you, but in Morocco, we really did find ourselves winding through these really small streets, and I love compression, I love the sense of reveal on a project, and we're going to have it. I can't wait for you as guests to go down this, you know, take these like little dog, I call them dog leg turns, right? Little turns in the area of development as you wander through the streets, and these reveals that we have set up for you guys. It's exciting for me as a designer because the payoff is really watching you wander through the streets of this amazing place. But when we got back to WDI, some of the things we found in the markets were these amazing artisans. And so we had a lot of conversation about how do we bring these artisans, you know, or the sense of artistry to our planet. Oh, but this is one of my favorite. Oh, can you go back one? Yeah, or this is my favorite. This is my favorite photo to share with you tonight. This is why. If you turned around, when we took this photo, it was like $5, all taking a picture of the same wall. And if you turned around, there's this amazing palace right behind us that we didn't take one picture of. And the guy, it drove him crazy, right? Because he's like, no, sir, over here. But the palace is right behind us. And I'm like, no, I need to take a picture of this doorknob, right? And I'm like, right? And he's like, but over here, there's beautiful gardens. I'm like, no, but you don't understand. I want to take a picture of this dirty wall with these electrical boxes. And but the beauty in this is what Imagineers find the beauty in. In this paint, there's so many things that tell us and give us ideas. It's the texture of the plaster and the aging. It's how they patch the box into the wall. My favorite detail is how the electrical, the conduit doesn't come out of the box. It comes 18 inches off to the left, and it just comes out of the plaster for no odd reason, right?
We actually tried to avoid it.
I love this, right? And we bring photos like, we bring thousands of photos like this back to WDI, and we give these to the Imagineers because everyone finds a beauty in it. And so you will see this, I guarantee this, when you wander the streets of the two, you will find these details. So really quick, you can now see the influence of Morocco and Istanbul. This design is really what it will look like when you walk into the entrance to our market or our souk. But it was really based off the Grand Bazaar in Istanbul and walking into this grand space. But in the next painting, we compress that space. We bring it down. We make it a little bit more human in its relationship to you. And here you'll find all these little stalls that all have backstories. We may never share those backstories with you, but we know those backstories as Imagineers. It helps the design team craft each one of their individual stories. And I think the one little story we want to share with you tonight, which we haven't really shared today, is really our Tordarian story. So we have a toy maker in this market. It happens to be a female Tordarian. And you
have a Tordarian toy maker.
Yes.
Why about it?
It's in the name. It was like a gift, right there. Lucasfilm like lobbed it with the softball right there. Yeah. Anyway, it's Tordarian. They make toys. But we have a Tordarian. This is the rendering of what that shop will look like. And the beauty of this shop really is in the artistry. And you know, when we came back from our research trip, we met with our lines of business, the foods team, the merchandise team, and really sit down with them and talk a lot about authenticity. That the product that we sell here, the things that we want you to buy as fans. By the way, I'm a huge Star Wars toy fan. I know you guys are too. As the fans, you want something unique. You want something different. You want something that feels like it came from this planet. And so we've been working really hard with our merchandise partners, and we have a couple images to share with you. Really influenced by, here you can see, this is actually one of the toys that we'll be selling. This is an Atwalker, but it looks like it's crafted by, you know, an artisan who's hammering each little piece of metal out and setting the ribbons by hand. And a lot of these toys and images were really inspired also by some of the toys and things that we've seen in Rogue One and Episode 7 that Doug
So worked. Even the merchandise is exclusive to this
land. Oh, yeah.
Exclusive, just, you can only get a number two because it was made by a Toydarian.
Yeah, it has to be.
In-universe merchandise.
In-universe.
So I'm not going to go and buy a Star Wars t-shirt from this Toydarian.
No, you will not buy a Star Wars t-shirt.
That's incredible. So that is really, really, really cool.
So I have one last image to share with you, and this image, we've all seen blue milk, and we've seen now, as of last night, green milk, right? I'm excited, because Scott and I just came back from a trip where we got to sample a lot of blue and green milk.
About 30 different varieties.
And it was all good, trust me, so I think you guys are in for a treat in 2019. We're excited.
This is the aftermath here.
Yes, this is the aftermath.
Yeah.
Yes. That was very authentic though. I must say from Luke, right?
Wow, that's just absolutely incredible. I mean, there's just so many details that I just cannot wait to explore. And in 2019, you're still over a year out. There's still
But there's a lot of work happening, right? I mean, you saw the construction work that Robin shared, the aerial site. You can see what a big site it is. All the work that Chris and Doug and the hundreds of other Imagineers and members Lucasfilm and Imagineering and the parks that are working on it. And I promise you, we are working as hard and as fast as we can to bring those stories to life.
I absolutely cannot wait. And I understand, speaking of stories, you had something that you wanted to share with
me. Yeah. So we love sharing this stuff with you guys, because as I said before, we do this for the fans. We love the opportunity to share more details, more of the stories behind the stories with you. 2019 is still a year away, but because we love planting the seeds for these stories with you, we want you guys tonight to be the first to receive a brand new thing that we're doing, which is a collection of Star Wars Galaxy's Edge trading cards. Yeah. So for the first time tonight, on you guys on your way out of the park, not out of the theater tonight, but on your way out of the park, you'll be the first to get the first starter set of Star Wars Galaxy's Edge trading cards, which help set the stories, plant the seeds, introduce you to some characters that you're going to meet along the way. I can't wait to share more with you along.
That's awesome. Reminder, so it's not on the way out of this theater, it's on the way out of the park at the end of the night. You'll all get to have these trading cards from Batuu and learn just a little bit more.
There may be some secrets and surprises in here too.
Very, very cool.
Maybe.
Well, this is great. I know I can't wait to hear what's next on the journey to creating this incredible immersive experience. I just love talking to you guys. I can do this forever. I know there's so much in Black & Knights to explore. Please join me in giving them a huge round of applause.